Hello and welcome to this Worship at Home online service for Sunday the 18th of July from me, Julian Hartley, the Vicar of St Paul's Church in Astley Bridge. In this service, the Bible readings are from Mark's Gospel chapter 6 and St Paul's letter to the Ephesians chapter 2, the part in which Paul writes about unity and that I'm going to pick up on in my sermon this week. The reading from Mark's Gospel is picked up by Roger in the prayers with church leadership and ministry in mind. That's because Susan has successfully completed her ministry training and was licensed as a reader last Sunday and begins that ministry with us as she helps lead our Holy Communion service in church this Sunday. This Sunday is the last one before the pandemic control restrictions are lifted. At the time of putting this service together, I'm still waiting to see what that entails for us. Detailed guidance from the government and National Church of England authorities is on its way. It's looking likely that we'll gradually relax the measures that we've had in place, rather than rushing to remove them too quickly. I know that one thing that many people are keen to get back to doing is singing in church. At least you've always been able to sing at home for these online services, and as usual, the words for the hymns this week will be on the screen so that you can join in with them. Now, let's begin with our usual words of encouragement from the Bible and a prayer. So hear these words from Psalm 29. The Lord gives strength to his people, and the Lord blesses his people with peace. And our response as the night has passed and a new day lies ahead of us is to pray with one heart and mind. As we receive the gift of this new day, O God, strengthen us and give us peace in it. Amen.
Thank you. Mark chapter 6, beginning at verse 30. The apostles returned to Jesus from their ministry tour and told him all they had done and taught. Then Jesus said, "Let's go off by ourselves to a quiet place and rest a while." He said this because there were so many people coming and going that Jesus and his apostles didn't even have time to eat. So they left by boat for a quiet place where they could be alone. But many people recognized them and saw them leaving. And people from many towns ran ahead along the shore and got there ahead of them. Jesus saw the huge crowd as he stepped from the boat, and he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. Verse 53. After they had crossed the lake, they landed at Gennesaret. They brought the boat to shore and climbed out. The people recognized Jesus at once, and they ran through the whole area carrying sick people on mats to wherever they heard he was. Wherever he went, in villages, cities, or the countryside, they brought the sick out to the marketplaces. They begged him to let the sick touch at least the fringe of his robe, and all who touched him were healed. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We begin our prayer time reminding ourselves of these words in our Gospel reading from St. Mark. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And so we pray, Good Shepherd of the sheep, we thank you that you continue to call men and women to be a shepherd in your church. Thank you for calling Julian to be our vicar. Thank you for calling Susan to be our reader. Thank you for calling Ben in his leadership of the Antioch churches in the diocese, and for calling Lee as he takes over from Ben soon at Oldham's church. Equip each one for all the challenges of their ministry. Give them wisdom. Give them vision as they lead. Give them compassion as they pastor. And as they share the good news of Jesus, give them fruit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Good Shepherd of the sheep, we thank you that through your reconciling death and resurrection, we can draw near to you together. As one people, irrespective of colour, gender or background. Have mercy on our country as we continue to be so painfully and graphically reminded of our divisions, prejudices and lack of compassion for each other. Pour out your Holy Spirit in saving power, that men and women may be born anew into a community where Jesus breaks down barriers, heals hurts, and creates a community of love and acceptance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Good Shepherd of the sheep, who looks in compassion at the crowds, we thank you for the many groups and people who are channels of that compassion today in our world. We remember now two of our mission partners. First, we pray for urban outreach. In particular, we pray for them as they prepare to feed thousands of needy children in Bolton during the summer holidays. We name before you David and Chris Bagley as they lead, and each member of staff we commit to you now. And further afield in Uganda, we pray for the Baguma family as they serve you with Mission Aviation Fellowship. amidst all the chaos and pain caused by the pandemic. Look after Sam and Abby and the children. Protect them. Give them joy in you and meet each of their needs. Lord, in your mercy. And finally, Good Shepherd of the Sheep, we are challenged as we have read these words in today's Gospel. As soon as they got out of the boat, people recognised Jesus. Lord, as we go out and about in our daily lives, this week in particular, may people recognise Jesus in and through us. Lord, in your mercy.
Taken from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 to 22. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands, remember that at the time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access to the Father by the Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I usually think of today's Bible reading from Ephesians back in January, when the Week of Prayer for Christian Unity takes place. But it's in the Church of England's schedule of readings for this Sunday, so I'll run with it for my sermon today. St. Paul, who wrote the letter, was writing about unity amongst the people of God. In his day, there were the Jewish people who were the people of God and who regarded themselves as exclusively the people of God. And there was everyone else, the non-Jewish people, labelled as Gentiles. These were not regarded as the people of God unless they chose to convert to the Jewish faith and followed the laws and customs of it. But along comes Jesus Christ, who, as St. Paul wrote, came and preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. Looking at the context in which Paul was writing, he was saying, so Christ came and preached the good news of peace to all, to you Gentiles who were far away from God and to the Jews who were near to him. And that's how one of the modern English translations of the Bible, the Good News Bible, puts it. Paul's recurring message was that those who come to a faith in Christ, in other words, the Christians, are counted equally as being amongst God's people. It's there in today's Bible reading. Remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. but now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. His purpose was to create in himself one new people out of the two, thus making peace, and in this one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. That's how it was written by St. Paul. There is then supposed to be a unity amongst God's people. Sadly, though, throughout the centuries there have been too many divisions, and that's just within the Christian church, amongst Christian people. If we, who are supposed to be united and at peace with one another, can't work that out, how on earth can we expect there to be peace on earth between everyone else? If the Christian church can't set a good example of unity, then that undermines the mission we have to the rest of the people of the world, the call to faith and love and peace and unity. If, in Christ's name, Christians can't demonstrate unity, is there any wonder that people outside of the church question what benefit there is in turning to Christ and being a Christian? Christian unity, worldwide, between denominations and between groups within the same denomination, nationally and locally, it's something I'm passionate about. For 9 years, I was the secretary of the Board of Mission and Unity in the Liverpool Diocese, and that work kept me in touch with ecumenical moves like ARCIC, the Anglican Roman Catholic International Commission, and the Methodist Anglican Conversations, and called to be one and more besides. Those things that were going on to explore and see if we could achieve unity amongst the various Christian denominations of the Church. So perhaps it's understandable that I should be so keen on Christian unity and have a desire to explore reconciliation between church denominations. After all, in our Holy Communion service we have the Nicene Creed, in which we say, "We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church." Catholic, not Roman Catholic, but Catholic in the sense of universal. We believe in one universal and apostolic church. Yet still I hear, "I am not of your religion," said between Roman Catholics and Protestants, or between Pentecostals and others. When planning joint activities, we know that if certain groups of Christian are involved, others won't join in. But in today's Bible reading from Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 14, it was said, "For Christ himself has brought us peace by making Jews and Gentiles one people. With his own body he broke down the wall that separated them and kept them enemies." If Christ can do that between Jew and Gentile, can't he do it between Catholic and Protestant, Pentecostal and other? Won't we let him? Amongst his people, the Jewish people, God recognized 12 tribes, yet they were still as one people. We may have many tribes, as it were, based on our denominations, yet we are still, in a way, one people. We may keep our different traditions, customs, ways of organizing ourselves, yet at heart we can still be one people. There is unity from being of one family. In John's Gospel, chapter 17 and verses 20 to 21, it's recorded that Jesus said, "I pray not only for them, but also for those who believe in me because of their message. I pray that they may all be one, Father. May they be in us, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they be one, so that the world will believe that you sent me." The unity for which he prays is a unity that involves love. And elsewhere in John's Gospel, chapter 13 and verse 35, It's recorded that Jesus said, "If you have love for one another, then everyone will know that you're my disciples." That has clear implications for our mission as a church. Disunity between denominations, disunity between Christians from different groups, is appalling. It's unbiblical. It's disobedient to God and damaging to the mission that God has entrusted to us. There ought to be reconciliation and unity. For we believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We say we believe it. Let's live it. In church terms, we come from different traditions, yet still are united as one by the cross. The cross, the symbol of our faith, the symbol of our unity. All over the place, Christians in many man-made denominations, the Roman Catholics, the Anglican, the Methodist, the Baptist, the Pentecostal, and so on, are all united by the cross. The cross, something that's central to our communion service, a service in which our prayer book reminds us, Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross, and we meet in his name and share his peace. And it also reminds us, let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. Let us recognize that unity and do all that builds up our common life. Let us recognize it here and amongst ourselves. For just as it was in St. Paul's day when he wrote that letter to the Ephesians, so it is today here that, as St. Paul wrote, you too are being built together with all the others into a place where God lives through his Spirit. That is the work that God is doing. Let's make sure that by the power and grace of God at work amongst us, it continues to happen, so that in the days to come, there may be good news to be told from this place. In the name of Christ. Amen. And now let us affirm our faith, the faith that we share with Christians around the world, as we join together in saying the words of the Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. The Grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and evermore. Amen. And now and in the weeks to come, may God the Holy Trinity make you all strong in faith and love, defend you on every side, and guide you in truth and peace. And so may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you now and remain with you always. Amen.